Hello everyone, this is Dr. Fox. Let's talk about the structure of the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system. In this video, we'll discuss how the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system is structured. So recall that the sympathetic division is oftentimes referred to as the thoracolumbar output or outflow, and it gets that name because it is arising from spinal levels T1 through L2. And that signal is carried out through portions of spinal nerves and conducted to the sympathetic trunk from levels T1 through L2. The connection between the ventral primary rami of spinal nerves and the sympathetic trunks are known as white rami communicantes, or white communicating branches. So the overall distribution of white rami communicantes starts with T1 and moves distally along the length of the spinal cord until L2. So above the level of T1, there is no connection between the central nervous system and the sympathetic trunk. Below the level of L2, there is no connection between the sympathetic nervous system and the spinal cord. All of that communication is between T1 through L2. So it's the preganglionic fibers which are originating in the spine and coming out into the sympathetic trunk, where most of them are going to synapse in ganglia, which constitute quite a bit of the trunk. We'll discuss the specific route by which they reach to those ganglia, but the connections of the white rami communicantes are between the ventral primary rami, or the VPR of the spinal nerve, and the sympathetic trunk. There are other connections between the sympathetic trunks and spinal nerves, and these are called gray rami communicantes. So gray rami communicantes occur at every level of the vertebral column. And so from the superior cervical ganglion, just inferior to the skull, all the way down to the ganglion impar, just anterior to the coccyx, we have a means by which signal from the sympathetic trunk can either go back to individual spinal nerve levels or move out to viscera. And it's through these gray rami communicantes, which are going to connect the sympathetic trunk to the ventral primary rami of spinal nerves, that postganglionic fibers, or most postganglionic fibers, are going to travel. So preganglionic fibers via white rami communicantes, postganglionic fibers through gray rami communicantes. Now let's take a look at the pathway by which these fibers are going to travel. So here we can see the spinal cord. This is the anterior side of the cord, and this is the posterior side of the cord. And so within the gray matter here and there, we can see two lateral horns. Within these lateral horns are the intermediolateral nuclei of the spinal cord, or the IML for short. So these preganglionic sympathetic fibers originate in the IML, or the lateral horns, and they are going to exit from the cord via ventral rootlets. So we can see the ventral rootlets here. The ventral rootlets are going to coalesce into the ventral root of the spinal nerve. The ventral root meets up with the dorsal root of the spinal nerve to form the trunk of the spinal nerve. That trunk is going to be mixed, so both afferent and efferent fibers, or sensory and motor fibers, and it can be divided into the dorsal primary ramus or the DPR, the ventral primary ramus, or the VPR. So from the ventral primary ramus, we can see that there are two connections to the sympathetic trunk. The first, which is along the pathway from the IML through the ventral rootlets, through the ventral root, through the trunk, through the ventral primary ramus, is going to be the white ramus communicans. So those white rami communicantes carry the preganglionic fibers into the sympathetic trunk, which is represented here by that ganglion and that fiber. Once those fibers get into the trunk, they may do several different things. Probably the most obvious of all the things that they may do, and here let's repeat this route. So we start in the IML, we exit the spinal cord via the ventral rootlets, through the ventral root, through the trunk of the spinal nerve, through the ventral primary ramus, out the white ramus communicans, and we're into the sympathetic trunk. And here we are seeing that the first of all the possible things that may happen is that that preganglionic sympathetic fiber can synapse. Once it synapses, we have a postganglionic fiber, which is exiting the trunk via a gray ramus communicans and going back to the ventral primary ramus of the spinal nerve. And it can distribute itself through the dorsal primary ramus or the ventral primary ramus. Either way. Another option is that the preganglionic fiber can enter into the, the preganglionic fiber can enter into the trunk via the white ramus communicans, and that it may ascend or extend the trunk. It can go either way. And then it may synapse. In this case, it's descending. It synapses, and then it returns back to another spinal nerve at a lower level. Or if it ascends, it can go back at a higher level. The fourth option is that the preganglionic sympathetic fiber can leave the spinal nerve via the white ramus communicans, and it can exit the trunk without ever synapsing. And in this case, it's going to contribute to something called a splanchnic nerve. A splanchnic nerve is a nerve that serves viscera. That's what splanchnic means. And so we'll see later on in the M1 experience how these splanchnic nerves are going to exit the thoracic cavity and enter into the abdominal cavity to participate in various perivascular plexuses and synapse in pre-aortic ganglia. But that story is for a later date. For now, simply know that preganglionic fibers can, when they enter the trunk, synapse, descend the trunk, then synapse, ascend the trunk, then synapse, and then finally return back to spinal nerves via gray rami communicantes, or leave the spinal nerve as a fiber. Or they may pass through the ganglia without synapsing as a part of a spinal nerve. So postganglionic fibers, as we've discussed, have a couple of options for what they'll do. Once they synapse, they can return to the ventral primary ramus or a ventral primary ramus at any particular level, and they can go out along the primary rami, either the dorsal or the ventral, to serve various regions of the body. They may also leave as a fiber from the ganglion or from the nerve and participate in paravascular plexuses. A paravascular plexus is a meshwork of autonomic fibers that are transmitted along a vascular pathway or an arterial pathway out to a target organ. So there are different types of fibers depending on the target organs that they affect. So we can categorize these visceromotor fibers as vasomotor fibers. Vasomotor fibers are going to target the smooth muscle of blood vessels. So when they are stimulated, there is vasoconstriction. When they are not stimulated, there is vasodilation. There are also pseudomotor fibers or secretomotor fibers, which are going to stimulate sudoriferous glands or sweat glands. These postganglionic fibers oftentimes are going to, especially in the abdominal pelvic cavity, participate, as well as in the thoracic cavity, in autonomic plexuses. These autonomic plexuses are going to be in meshworks of postganglionic sympathetic fibers and oftentimes preganglionic parasympathetic fibers that serve target organs. And in block three, we'll see how splanchnic nerves that are arising from the thoracic sympathetic trunks can leave the trunks and descend down into the abdominal cavity to serve viscera there. So we've discussed the overall structure of the sympathetic nervous system and the various pathways that both pre and postganglionic fibers are going to take from the lateral horns of the spine out to the target tissues. This is your summary slide. Thank you very much for your time.